Welcome to Applied Mathematical Finance and its object-oriented implementation. We started now introducing a big term structure model, big model for the whole interest rate curve. So a discrete forward rate term structure model. So the word discrete here referred to the fact that we have some discretization of the time axis in terms of maturities, so in terms of interest rate periods. So we started with a model specification. We had fairly general model specification assuming this tenor discretization. So our model specification is here. So this is our model. We just model each forward rate as an ETO process. So here we assume some local volatility function. So that is here this parameter sigma and the Brownian motions, they are allowed to have correlations. So that will be important later when we talk about the efficient implementation of the drift. Okay, so why? Because the drift, yeah, we move to the equivalent martingale measure, then by Gesanov we get a change of drift, and we know that certain objects are martingales or should be martingales under that measure. And it turned out that then the drift has to be a function of actually this covariance structure. And later we will see that there is a question, how can we efficiently calculate this drift? How can we implement this efficiently? So to derive the drift, we have the choice, you know, what is our numerator? We already derived the drift under terminal measure. So terminal measure is the equivalent martingale measure corresponding to the numerator. That is here the terminal bond, so the zero-core bond associated with the end of our time discretization, so that pays one unit at Tn. And deriving the drift proceeds, well, always in similar step. You look for martingales. So you know that here Pti divided by Ptn is a martingale. Okay, Ptn is our numerator. So this is a traded asset divided by my numerator. So this should be a Qn martingale. And then you express this martingale in terms of your model primitives, the objects that form your model. So this is here. So you know that taking the differential of this object will result in an ETO process that has a zero drift. And from that condition, so this is here our condition, I like to derive equations for the drifts. So if I have here n different forward rates, I have n different drifts, so I need n equations. But luckily, we have n equations because we have n different financial products here. Okay, so that was the derivation of the drift, applying ETO's formula, applying a few simplifications, and then we finally got here this nice equation for the drift under the terminal measure. Okay, so we can use a different numerator. So a very popular numerator is the bot measure numerator. So what's that? We already encountered this. It's the reinvestment in the zero-coupon bond that matures at the end of the next period. So we have this rolled over one period bond. So that is here the zero-coupon bond that matures at the end of the period, where little t, so our simulation time, is residing in. So m of t is the index that belongs to the time discretization point at the beginning of the period, and mt plus one is the one that belongs to the end of the period. So I have here my period. So this here is the ti, and this here is the ti plus one. So then if this here is my little t, my simulation time, so the simulation time can move on a finer time discretization. Yeah, so it is reasonable that the tenor discretization, the capital T discretization is contained in a little t discretization later when we perform time discretization of simulation time. But currently, simulation time little t is a continuum, yeah, because we are also differentiating the processes. And yeah, in that case here, I is m of t. So we defined this financial product before. So what does it mean? So it means that we have an investment in t0, where our numerator is equal to 1. And then we perform the successive reinvestment of this amount into the zero coupon bond that matures at the end of the period. So if we do that, we receive at the end of the first period 1 plus the interest rate earned over that period. So this is here the interest rate earned over the period. It's the L I delta I, so that's the excess amount. So we accumulate actually that amount here over this period. So we, at the end, we receive that amount and we accumulate this over all the periods. And then if we are currently here in little t, so this guy here is t mt plus 1. So then we invest in the zero coupon bond that matures at the end of the period. So we are currently in this financial product, in the blue financial product. Okay, so the nice thing about this numerator is that it doesn't make an assumption about the time horizon. So this is also for an implementation maybe nice. So you can extend your model later when you need, say, more points in the future. You cannot do this under the terminal measure because changing to a different time horizon in the terminal measure is a change of measure, and you have to recalculate all the stochastic processes, all the drifts. So you already see that there are specific implementational, so from a computer implementation, differences related to the choice of the numerator. On the other hand, the terminal measure has a nice property because we know that the last forward rate is a martingale. Here, actually, there's no forward rate as a martingale because we are continuously shifting the zero coupon bond. So you see, this guy also has a disadvantage compared to the other measure. And it may depend a little bit on the application, which one has better properties related to numerical or properties. As before, I introduce a small shortening here of the notation. So you see, I use here the delta J for the time period length. Yeah? So to make the notation a bit shorter. And let's go quickly through the derivation of the drift here and then discuss a little bit the differences of the two. Now, as before, we define a martingale, or we are looking for a martingale. So that here is a traded asset. So I have a bond that matures in TI. I have n different such bonds for in my time discretization. So if you do not include the one in T0, it's in T1 from T1 to Tn, because the one in T0 is trivial. And you can then rebase them to n relative prices, so to your numerator. So you know that these guys here are martingales. Yeah? So we know that they have drift Q0 under Qn, so under my measure. So this stuff here is a martingale. So I just plug in my definition of my numerator. My definition of my numerator is the bond that matures at the end of the period multiplied with all the interest I have earned over that period. So this is this factor here. Well, I divide by it, but here I have a to the power of minus one. So you know that the ratio of two bonds So this part here, this is a forward bond. Yeah. So I have the ratio of two bonds. So if your time discretization is here, so that here is actually my current time, little t. So then this guy here is the tm t plus one. So my starting point, and then I have a time discretization. And assume that this guy here is the ti. So then you know that what enters into this ratio is actually the interest rates over these periods here. Yeah, bond at the end divided by bond at the beginning. Well, when we defined the interest rate, it was bond at the beginning divided by bond at the end is the product of one plus interest earned over this time. So you see that this first factor there, the pound one, is just the product over the interest rates, starting here in TMT plus one, ending in TI. So a first little observation, which will come up later again, is that this part here is not entering. No? It's because I look here at this ratio, and this bond here goes from here to the end, and that bond here goes from here to here. So in this ratio, this part cancels. So the nice thing is that we do not even need to model this thing here. I already made the remark that this interest rate for the short period is missing in my model. So everything that is left is here the interest rate for the future periods, which is part of my model, which is nice. The remaining part is just a constant, yeah, because these guys here have already been fixed in the past. Yeah? So this is Tj, where Tj runs up to where j runs up to mt. So this is for me just a constant. Yeah? These are the past fixed interest rates. So if I differentiate this, there's nothing happening. So I know that the drift of this object here has to be zero because a factor, yeah, in front of the dt part doesn't matter. So that's now our condition. So what is the drift of this part? So I differentiate this. So you see that the constant factor is just here. So I just need to look at the differential of this product, the product from mt plus one to I minus one, one plus interest rate times period length, well, to the power of minus one. So it's one divided. This is a very similar expression as we had for the terminal measure, except that the product runs between different bounds. So now I have that the product runs between different bounds, and I have here to the power of minus one. Like for the terminal measure, if you differentiate this, you will apply Itô's lemma or the product rule. The product rule for a product that has multiple factors. But just as a reminder, if you have a product of two factors, so then I get the first order terms, and I also get the second order terms, since we have stochastic processes. So I have the same thing here. So I get the first order terms, which is differentiate one guy from the product and multiply this remaining product with the inner derivative. So multiply it with differentiating this one guy. So this here is the corresponding differentiation of that factor. Yeah. And do that for all factors. So take the sum over these guys. So I take here the sum over these guys. So this is this sum here. Then in addition, we have also plus differentiating the second order terms. So this now means that I differentiate this guy twice, so differentiate two factors out of this product and multiply with the differentials of these two guys. So I multiply with the dx dy why. Okay, so this is here my second order part. And inside these guys, I now have the differentiation of the 1 divided by the stochastic process. So I have here this 1 divided by 1 plus delta k l k. So what's that? So you remember this is just differentiate 1 divided by x, yeah, in Itô's lemma. So I get minus 1 divided by x squared times dx. And then in Itô's lemma, I get plus 1 half, but differentiating minus 1 divided by x squared gives me a plus 2. So I get plus here. I get 1 divided by x to the power of 3 dx dx. So you see that I also get these brown parts. So I get here a 1 divided by x squared multiplied with the inner derivative. The inner derivative is my dlj delta j here with a minus. And I get the second order differentiation of the 1 divided by x. So I get the 1 divided by x to the power of 3 times delta j squared dlj dlj. And I also get the same for the mixed parts. Yeah, so we also have here inside these guys, the inner derivatives of this 1 divided by 1 plus delta j lj. Okay, apart from this, this looks very similar. It looks now so similar to the derivation of the drift under the terminal measure. It looks now a little bit more complicated because, well, we have many additional terms. We have these guys here. Okay, but the funny thing is all these guys won't matter because they will just vanish. We now apply the same trick as before. So you see there is here a 1 divided by 1 plus delta j lj to the power of 2. But this factor is exactly the factor that is missing here in this product. Yeah. So k is not equal j. So actually, I can move one of these guys into the product. So I can remove that guy and I write here a 1. And the same here. So I write here a 2. So 1 divided by has been moved back to the product. And I can do the same here. So I can move the 1 plus delta j lj to the power of minus 1. I can move that one back to the product. And I can also take one here out. And since here I had 2 indices which were not part of the product, I have to do this also here for the other guy. So this is nice because now this product here is independent of J and can move in front of the sum. Okay, and here it's independent of J and L and can move also in front of the sum. So it can move in front of this whole expression. Now observe that whenever I have here 3 differentials coming together, this is 0, yeah, because I have dt, dt, dt is 0 because dt, dt is already 0. Dt, dw, dw is 0 because dt, dw is already 0. Dw, dw is dt. So dw, dw, dw will be a dt, dw, which is also 0. So whenever they are 3 guys coming together, so these things are 0. So this means that here, if I multiply these products, actually multiplying this factor with any of these is 0, and multiplying this factor with any of these is 0. So actually for my drift, I can conclude that these guys, they do not enter into the consideration. Okay, so these guys will be 0. Okay, so that makes the whole thing much nicer, because now only the guys with one differential and only the guys with two differentials will occur. Okay, so these are these guys here. This guy has one differential. These guys here, these guys have, this guys have two differential. And then the product of this and that. And you see that the product of this guy and this guy is just the minus delta J DLJ minus delta L DLL. So it's just the mixed term. So we have these three guys, the one with one differential, the one with two differentials JJ, and the mixed terms. And now you see that here in this mixed term, this one is just the mixed term here where J is equal to L, right? Yes, you see here is a minus minus. This is a plus anyway. Then we have a delta J, delta J, so delta L. So this will give me here my delta L, delta J squared. So this is nice. So I can actually drop this one here by just letting this sum here run also over L equal to J. Okay, so I let this run over L equal to J, so that's here. So now the sum is much nicer. And now you have an expression that looks very similar to what we had before for the terminal measure. The only difference is there is here a different sign. Yeah, and actually the sums, they run over different indices. So now, I have the fact that I can drop this factor here because I'm only interested in where the drift is zero. So it's enough to just consider here this part. Yeah? So that the drift of this sum is zero. Okay, so the drift of a sum is zero if the sum of the drift is zero. So I have here this nice condition that the sum of the drift drifts of these expressions is zero. And we have this for all I from mt plus one to n, because these are the financial products which we consider, so our zero Cooper bonds, which we consider. So the remaining zero Cooper bonds now give us these equations for the remaining forward rates. If I have this for all I can now proceed here step by step forward. I start with I equals mt plus one. And I see, since there is no I inside this condition here, I see that the drift of this condition is zero. So the drift of this expression is zero for j equals mt plus one. So for a single J. And then I can move forward again. I take the sum up to MT plus two. But since I already know that the first summand was zero, I know that also the second summand is zero. So I know that this condition actually has to hold for all J. So now the nice thing is that this condition holds for all J without the sum. Let's plug in the definition of our stochastic process. So I plug in here the DLJ. So this is the mu J dt plus sigma dwj. And I plug in also here the covariance part. So the DLJ DLL, DLJ DLL is my rho JL sigma J sigma L dt, and I compare the coefficient in front of the dt, so I can ignore the dw part, and I get that this has to be zero. So you see that this guy here also appears here in the sum, so it can cancel out here. And you have that minus mu plus this sum is zero, so mu is equal to this sum. So we have now our drift under terminal measure. Very similar derivation. So now let's compare the two drifts. So we have here this sum. So the sum from, so what is the difference? What is the difference to the drift of the terminal measure? So here the sum runs from mt plus one to j. Yeah, so L is larger than mt. Yeah, so the first index L is that for the period after the time where we are. Okay, though that's maybe reasonable. So, and the sum runs up to j. So j is the index of the forward rate for which I observe the drift. And the remaining part here is really the same. So it's this coefficient here, delta j divided by 1 plus delta j lj, and then the covariance term. So recall here, that's the same term inside the sum for the terminal measure. So this here is now the terminal measure drift. And you see that here the sum runs different. And another difference is that we have a minus. So maybe I draw a little picture here. So this here is my time horizon. This is my time discretization for the interest rate curve. So maybe I am currently at this point here. So this is my simulation time, little t. And then I observe the drift here. I observe the drift for an interest rate, which is at the period from, say, tj to tj plus one. So this is the drift that I observe. So here is my mu j. Then you see that for the terminal measure, so what's entering is actually, so let's draw now terminal measure maybe in a brown color. So for my terminal measure, I'm looking here at the interest rate periods. So the covariance of these interest rates in the future. Yeah? So you see these guys enter here in the sum, and the drift is here with a minus. Maybe I draw another one so it is a little bit longer. Well, these guys enter here. So now look at the spot measure. So I have a plus, and the sum now runs from mt plus one to j, j included, okay? And it has a plus. So I run from the period starting in mt plus one to j. So the interest rate for the period tj to tj plus one enters. Yeah? So look again, you have here that L can be equal to j. So that means if I look at the interest rate j, I have the covariance of dlj with dlj. So I have the variance, the instantaneous variance term of the interest rate with itself. But this guy also enters here into the sum, and here the sum is with a plus. Nice thing is that this part here does not enter, so this part here does not enter because it cancels out in my time discretization. So you see that somehow the spot measure is really the opposite guy. Yeah, it's looking more before the current period, yeah, because it's always the current zero coupon bond. And the terminal measure is looking at all the periods that are after the current period. And you also see this, the covariance of the interest rate with itself enters into the drift. So since that guy enters here into the drift of mu j, there is no forward rate that is a martingale for the terminal measure. Actually, the last one is the martingale, because then there is nothing left in the future that could enter into the drift. Another thing is the sign. We will later do an experiment, numerical experiment, where we compare the two measures. And you see that if you think, for example, of the stochastic differential equation being in log normal form, yeah, so assume you have dLj is mu j plus sigma jLj dw, then, so this here was our sigma L, then you have that this coefficient here is my sigma j, yeah, so my sigma j of t and Lj, right? So this coefficient here is the sigma j. And you see that in this formulation, there will also be an L here. Yeah? So this will be then the, how does the drift then look like? So the drift will be then some mu j, say superscript L for log normal now. This is now my log normal drift. This will be some sum. And then in this sum, there is an Lj LL sigma j sigma j rho. Yeah. Okay, so I just want to point out that there is also the L inside here. So sometimes you see the drift written with an additional L here in front, if you have an additional L here. But actually, that has to be proven that there is an L, huh? That this drift is of this form. Okay. And now I want to make a comment related to the sign. You know that if you have an ODE that is of the form dLj is mu j Lj dt. Well, if there would be no dw, okay, then there would be no mu. But if, say, for example, the dw is small, so I can maybe neglect this for a second, then you see if mu would be a constant, the solution of this is exponential mu t. So you have exponential growth with the growth rate mu. And you see that there the sign could make a difference. Here the drift is somehow dampening the growth. No? And here it's somehow creating exponential growth in a log normal model. So numerically, maybe the spot measure numerair will create some growth in the forward rates. Well, taking the numerair pre-based expectation, this growth goes away because your numerair also has exponential growth. But this may be a numerical issue. We have to investigate this a little bit later. So that was just a concluding remark to give you more intuition how this drift looks like and what is the difference of the drifts. Of course, you can construct many different other numerairs. So now we had here two different numerairs, two different drifts. Another popular one is the TK forward measure. So the TK forward measure is the one where I choose the zero Cooper bond that matures at time TK. So somehow I have a similar situation like for the terminal measure. But instead of now choosing the last zero Cooper bond, I choose now one that matures here. So there is here, say, a TK where I'm maturing. I choose that zero Cooper bond. The nice property is that the forward rate that resides here in this period
is a martingale. But now, since time can move on, I have to specify what happens after this point. And after this point, I just use the rolling reinvestment in the next zero coupon bond. So I somehow have spot measure here with a different starting value, and I have terminal measure here. And then I switch. Yeah? So if you switch, you have a different starting value. So you see that this guy here starts then with one unit in TK, and not with one unit in T0. That's maybe also a nice numeraria, depending on your application. So here's the drift. Yeah, not surprisingly, it's before time TK, it's just the terminal measure drift. And after time TK, it's just the spot measure drift. And in the periods in between, I have the nice property that there is a forward rate that has drift zero. Okay, so let me make a nice remark on this short period bond. That's a strange thing in my model. We model just the interest rates for the future period. Maybe let's take this picture here. So we just model the interest rates for fixed periods. Okay, but in the definition of my numeraria, there also appeared, so for the spot measure, here this short period bond. So the reinvestment in the zero coupon bond that matures at the end of the next period. And this object does not enter. So a little bit, we have the situation that my model is incomplete, because there is a gap. I do not have a model for this object here. So if simulation time little t is not in my time discretization, the numeraria n of t of the terminal measure and the spot measure, they are not known. Well, because this interest rate over this short period at the beginning, which is part of both financial products. Actually, in the spot measure, you see it explicitly. In the terminal measure, you also know it because you need this interest rate actually to jump to the next interest rate period for which you all need know all the interest rates. But this guy is not part of the model, so I do not know these numerarias at these times. So I only know the numeraria at the time discretization points. And that's then the reason for the fact that I can only value zero coupon bonds at the time discretization points with this model. If the time discretization, the tenor discretization is fine, maybe that's not a problem. For the model of our forward rates, the specification of this guy is irrelevant. So as long as I'm only interested in the forward rates, and as long as I have, for example, payments only at the tenor discretization, then this specification is irrelevant because it also dropped out in the derivation of the drift. So what is now the role of this bond? So conversely, my model does not give me any information of this. So the specification of this short period bond becomes relevant if we like to look at interest rates on periods which are not in my time discretization. So this applies to the period where you are actually in, trivially. So if you are here, then of course the short period bond defines you this period here, but it also becomes relevant when you look at an interest rate period which crosses somehow the boundaries, So, for example, if you have some interest rate from TS, T start to TE, T end, yeah, where T start and T end are not part of the time discretization. So then this short period bond describes us how the interest rate curve is interpolated. So how the shape of the interest rate curve looks in between our time discretization. If the zero coupon bond for this short period has zero volatility, then actually our model is equivalent to a Heath-Jerome-Morton model with a very special volatility structure, namely where all the forward rates for shorter period have zero volatilities shortly before they fix. So maybe I can just explain this when we talk a little bit about the relation to the Heath-Jerome-Morton framework. What's maybe a surprise is that there is no constraint how I choose this zero coupon bond. So I just explained it defines somehow how the interest rates are interpolated. Yeah. So this means depending on the interpolation I would like, I can choose now different short period bonds. But then maybe this would conflict with a no arbitrage argument. So you might think, okay, so this is strange. So why is it now a degree of freedom to choose this guy? So I can choose this guy here in my model if I like. I can just define it. Why is it now a degree of freedom? While all the other zero coupon bonds, even if they have now zero volatility, the drift is determined by the no arbitrage constraint from the equivalent martingale measure. So the reason is that this guy is special because in the condition of the zero coupon bond being a martingale, it cancels out. So you see, independent of how I choose this PTM T plus one, how I model it, it will always be a martingale because it is part of my numeraire. And you saw this also in other situations, maybe not so in this form. So it may come as a surprise, but you saw this before, because here in the Black-Scholes model, we had a similar situation. Yeah, so we could choose the interest rate R that enters into my bank account, BT, as a free parameter. Yeah? So it is the drift of the numeraire. Okay, and of course, the numeraire divided by the numeraire is always a martingale. Independent of how you choose this drift. So that explains why this guy here has a little bit a special property. Yeah? So it is the drift of your numeraire in between two time discretization points. So let's say here is Ti, Ti plus one. And now I have here my time. And your numeraire is known at the starting point. And at the end point. But in between, actually, it's up to you how you would like to connect these two points. Maybe I draw the first one a bit lower, then it's maybe a bit clearer. So here in between, it's up to you how you connect the two points, if you go that way or if you go that way. Yeah, it's up to you how you connect the two points. And the short period bond, the interest rate that is seen here over the end, is somehow the slope from there to there. So it somehow describes the slope of the remaining part. So it describes the shape of the numerator in between. So that's why this guy here is a free parameter. It models the shape of the numerator in between, the interpolation of the numerator in between. And since you can calculate all interest rates for future periods by taking expectations with respect to the numerator, yeah, so remember, expectation one divided by the numerator is a zero coupon bond. If you do that for different times, you get different zero coupon bonds. From these zero coupon bonds, you get the interest rates. Since this guy here describes the shape of the numerator for small periods in the future, it describes the interpolation of all these interest rates also in the future. This is a little bit similar what happens in a short rate model. Yeah, in the short rate model where you just describe the interest rate for the short period, a similar thing happens. So in such a model, the drift is also a free parameter. And maybe if you have learned short rate models before, if not, we can discuss this later. Then you know that for a short rate model, the drift is a free parameter, and you do not see all this change of measure, change of drift technique in this model. The reason is that the short rate R is the stochastic process that describes the numerator, the B, which is e to the integral R dt. So actually, the drift of the numerator is a free parameter. That is the short period bond. So now you have maybe a nice intuition what this object is. And it does not enter into our model as long as we are not interested in the numerator for the in-between times or in interest rates for, say, not aligned periods. As long as we are not interested in these objects, we do not need this guy. Okay, so that was a session on comparing the two measures and the short period bond. And maybe we can have a break here. So thank you.